Occidental Petroleum was founded in 1920 in California. The Oxy is now one of the largest oil and gas producers in the United States. The first 30 years were rather insignificant, and they were nearly bankrupt by the mid-1950s. In 1956, millionaire entrepreneur Armand Hammer and his wife both invested $50,000 into wells that Oxy planned to drill in California. When both wells struck oil, Armand decided he wanted to take a more active role in the company, and a year later he became the company's president. At this time, Oxy was producing around 100 barrels of oil per day. Armand set off to diversify Oxy from the beginning, stating that he wanted Oxy to be too big for any other major oil company to take over. And this began Oxy's long history of acquiring various businesses in and outside of the oil and gas industry. In 1959, 2 years after becoming president of the company, Oxy made their first hammer-led acquisition by acquiring the Gene Reed Drilling Company. In 1961, Oxy took a chance on the Lathrop oil field outside of San Francisco. And some say this was supposed to be a dry hole write-off for the company, but it actually ended up being one of the largest natural gas finds in all of California, worth a couple hundred million dollars. By the end of 1961, Oxy was reportedly bringing in over $1 million in profit on $4 million of revenue. By March 1964, Oxy's shares were also trading on the New York Stock Exchange. Throughout the 1960s, Hammer pushed Oxy to build up a more international presence with dealings in Turkey, Morocco, Venezuela, and Nicaragua. In 1966, Hammer negotiated with Libya's King Idris to reduce the nation's resources. This paid off when they discovered a billion barrel oil field, establishing Oxy as one of the largest petroleum companies in the world. Now, Oxy Libya, the wholly owned subsidiary, was producing 800,000 barrels per day by 1969, and such an amount made Oxy Libya the eighth largest producer in the entire world, only exceeded by the Seven Sisters. In 1981, Oxy ventured outside of energy and acquired the largest meat packer in the United States, Iowa Beef Packers. This cost them around $750 million, and around 6 years later, they were able to sell half of their meat packing operation for nearly $1 billion. In 1982, Oxy acquired a huge oil company out of Oklahoma called the City's Service Company for a staggering $4 billion. While this deal was viewed with skepticism by many, it made Oxy the eighth largest oil company in the United States. Hammer then sold most of the newly acquired downstream assets from Cities to the 7-Eleven Group. In 1985, they decided to expand their pipeline business and acquire the domestic pipeline behemoth MidCon Pipeline for $3 billion. Although Oxy had built up its vast upstream and midstream portfolio, its most profitable branch throughout the 1980s was its chemical branch, OxyChem. From 1983 to 1986, OxyChem was built almost entirely through acquisitions from Diamond Shamrock, DuPont, and Shell Chemical. In 1988, Oxy became the sixth largest chemical producer after acquiring Kane Chemical for $2.2 billion. Unfortunately, tragedy struck in July 1988 when Oxy's Piper Alpha offshore oil platform exploded in Britain's North Sea, killing 167 people, making it still the largest disaster in oil history today. Hammer was in hot water again with shareholders in the late 80s when Oxy funded a $95 million museum to house his $250 million art collection. Shortly after, he passed away at the age of 92. So Hammer's right-hand man, Ray Irani, who had served under Hammer as president and CEO for 6 years up to this point, took over as chairman of the board. Now, Irani quickly worked to reverse many of the pet projects that Hammer had gotten Oxy into in the previous four decades. He sold the meatpacking business, he stopped further investing into Arabian horses, and he sold its stake in Arm & Hammer, which was a business that Hammer got into because people thought he owned it anyways. Now, the art museum was sold to UCLA, along with the Leonardo da Vinci manuscript that Hammer had purchased for $5.5 million. Now, throughout most of the 90s, Irani worked to restructure the company and all of its subsidiaries in an attempt to create a more focused organization and to reduce the company's debt load. In 1997, they purchased Elk Hills, which was a huge oil field that was a part of the Naval Petroleum Reserve from the government for $3.65 billion. Now, to fund this acquisition, Oxy decided to sell its MidCon pipeline, the KN Energy, for $4 billion. As it entered the 21st century, Oxy continued its efforts to realign its core operations. The company ended its involvement in Venezuela and the North Sea, as well as trading its interests in the Philippines and Malaysia for interests in Yemen and Colombia. Oxy also sold off 30% of its Canadian branch for $700 million, which in part funded its next big acquisition. In April 2000, Oxy purchased the largest oil producer in the state of Texas, Alter Energy, a Permian-focused joint venture between Shell and BP for $3.6 billion. With proven reserves of 850 million barrels of oil equivalent, this acquisition boosted Oxy's daily crude production by more than 25% up to 407,000 barrels per day. In spring of 2004, U.S. sanctions against Libya were lifted and Irani sent a team over to bid on 15 oil-rich blocks in the Libyan desert and was able to secure 9 of them. Now, in an effort to bolster their core areas in California, the Middle East, and Latin America, Oxy makes yet another big move, acquiring Vintage Petroleum for $3.8 billion. In 2007, Oxy's compensation policies came under scrutiny after it was revealed that Irani received $460 million in compensation the previous year. This would ultimately lead to his ousting just 4 years later. In true Oxy fashion, the company continued to acquire and invest numerous assets across the globe. In 2008, they acquired a 10% stake in Plains All American Pipeline, as well as acquiring some assets from Plains Exploration and Production for $1.3 billion. In October 2009, they acquired Philbro Trading for approximately $250 million. And Philbro, which was headed up by Andy Hall, was probably their most controversial acquisition. Hall's $100 million per year compensation was equally, if not more, controversial. The unit was eventually shuttered and sold later in 2016. During 2010 and 2011, Oxy spent $4.6 billion acquiring assets in the Williston Basin in North Dakota, as well as properties across South Texas, though perhaps its biggest move during this time wasn't stateside. Oxy partnered with the Abu Dhabi State Oil Company to develop the largest natural gas field in all of the Middle East. During his 27 years as CEO, Ray Irani had grown Oxy's market cap from $5.5 billion to over $80 billion. It's also reported that he himself made over $1.2 billion in compensation during this time. But in May 2011, shareholders ousted Irani over the company's outlandish executive compensation policies and named Stephen Chazen as the new CEO. Though Irani probably had the last laugh, considering he received a $46 million severance package as well as $1 million per year for the rest of his life. In May 2016, an engineer who'd worked for the company since 1981, Vicky Hullab, was named CEO of Oxy. Fast forward to April 2019, Chevron attempted to close the sixth largest oil and gas deal in history by offering to acquire Anadarko Petroleum for around $50 billion. But thanks to a cash infusion of $10 billion from legendary investor Warren Buffett, Oxy was able to offer Anadarko $57 billion. Their offer was accepted, making it the fourth largest oil and gas deal to date. Now, at the time, Oxy's market cap sat around $50 billion, give or take, before its acquisition of Anadarko. And as of March 2020, is currently sitting at around just $10.3 billion. Activist investor Carl Icahn has since upped his stake in Oxy to around 10% and has publicly expressed his intention to oust the entire board of Oxy and take control. And that wraps up our history of Occidental Petroleum.